Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to talk to you about the history of transplantation in the Caribbean. To start off with, to set it in perspective, the kidneys are one of the vital organs. There are five vital organs. Some men seem to think we have six, but all the vital organs have been transplanted successfully, apart from the brain. The kidneys was the first to be transplanted. The anatomy, very briefly, there are two kidneys normally, although one in 1,200 persons are born with one kidney. And from that, we found out that we can actually take out a kidney and transplant it, because all you need is a half of what you need, 1.25 million nephrons in each kidney. The nephron is a strainer, much like that what you use in your kitchen. It strains the blood, the water part comes out as urine, and the solids stay behind. That's the size of a kidney. It fits in your hand, normal kidney. Now, very briefly, the physiology of the kidney, it eliminates toxins. When there's kidney failure, the toxins accumulate and go to the brain, causes cloudiness of the brain, comes through the gut, causes diarrhea and other problems in the bowel, comes out in the skin, causes itching. Water balance, when there is failure, water accumulates and you swell up. Electrolyte balance, main electrolyte it deals with, your potassium. When that accumulates, the muscles get weak. The main muscle is the heart. When the heart gets weak and stops, you die. It regulates your blood pressure. So in kidney failure, the blood pressure is always up. It regulates the formation of blood. So these patients are always anemic. And of course, acidosis from the pH. Now, transplantation, the forgotten surgical heroes. Transplants didn't start yesterday. All surgeons from time back have been trying to replace organs. The Chinese have it in their mythology that Huo To and Pen Xiu transplanted the leg of a Moor onto one of their heroes, and he was invincible after that. Of course, that we know now can't be so from what we talk about. John Hunter, the father of surgery, was also the father of transplantation. He tried to transplant pieces of one chicken onto another for years. Only one of the about 100 he did actually worked, and that kept him going. It's Lister and Morton were very essential to transplantation. Lister was the father of antisepsis. And without that, we wouldn't be able to transplant because, as you will see, infection is one of the things that is very fatal to transplant patients. Morton, the father of anesthesiology. Without anesthetics, it would be out. Now, transplant, and really transplant in the Caribbean, really started in 1905 when Ullman, Guthrie, and Carrell started working in Guthrie's lab in Chicago. They were working on transplants. And from then, they were transplanting kidneys in dogs. In 1913, Carrell won the Nobel Prize. He went home and produced the work they had done in Chicago and wrote it up. And up to this day, we still use the same stitch he used to transplant kidneys. In 1913, he wrote saying, the technical aspects of transplantation have been settled. And so from 1913 until now, there has been no improvement in how a kidney is put in. That's him, Carrell. And what they used to do in those days, because when they put in kidneys, they found that they would fail after a day or two. And so they would treat acute renal failure patients with transplants, hoping the transplant would last for a day, two, three, four, until the patient got over their acute renal failure, and so was okay. They used to put transplants in the thigh. That's a very interesting picture of a kidney transplant. Sorry. of a kidney transplant in the thigh, as there you had the femoral artery and femoral vein easily accessible, and so the patient would wee out the ureter into a container, and that would keep them going for 2 or 3 days until the kidney failed. They then had no inkling about the immune system. In 1954, things really started when in Boston, Murray et al. Transplanted monozygotic twins. And they realized that there was something that stopped kidneys from one person from working another. And since these twins were identical, they transplanted a kidney and it worked. Then they knew that there was really something in the immune system that was causing this not to work. The immune system is a very interesting part of our body. It accepts self, loves self, but non-self it attacks. And that is the whole gist of infections and cancer cells. Infections are seen as non-self, so the body attacks and you get a boil or other evidence of the body fighting against infection. Non-self, a kidney transplant, any transplant is regarded right away as non-self, so the body attacks it and you get a rejection. That led them on to the principle of immunosuppression, where immunosuppression is an attempt to calm down the immune system so that it accepts non-self. And in accepting non-self, other things occur. It opens the patient to infections and to cancers. So when you transplant a patient, put them on immunosuppression, they have a much greater likelihood of getting an infection, and the rate of cancer increases significantly. Transplant in the Western is really started in London way, way back, 1966, where there was a young Jamaican surgeon who got very disgruntled with everything and was reading to the cold afternoon. Inside his house was cold. He had a wife and a son and no money. He was reading the BMJ and saw a job for a fellow in urology advertised in Ottawa, Canada. The pay seemed very good. So he wrote off, not expecting to care. He got a reply in 2 weeks. Accepted, come. So at that stage, he was in training to be a plastic surgeon. So that was the end of plastic surgery. He went across to Ottawa, and from 1967 to 69, he trained as a nephrologist, learning about the new kidney machine, and on the transplant team and doing some urology. Well, he finished and went back to Jamaica. And in 1970, while walking on the corridors of the KPH, he saw this machine. It was a Colf dialysis machine, same one he had trained on in Ottawa. And it looked new, but it was there. So he got it, checked it out. And he advised the physicians that we could now treat chronic renal failure. We were to look out for patients. And so, in February 1970, a patient, DC, age 13, Dr. Miller will be happy to see the age, turned up with chronic glomerulonephritis. I was called to see the patient, and we decided to set the patient up by doing a fistula. But first of all, we had to get the machine working properly. So we contacted the agents for Colf, Hopwood, and without the help of these people, we'd have had no dialysis in Jamaica. David Hopwood was the head of Hopwood, and his assistant was Hermin Leehing, and she talked to him, and we got them to agree to buy a coil for the machine, fluids, tubings, everything. And so we went ahead and did a fistula on Dorrit Campbell. A fistula is to allow for access so we could put the patient onto the machine. And they ordered the parts for the dialysis machine, and we put the patient onto hemodialysis in February, March 1970, and in September, a head injury turned up, which had ABO compatibility, meaning the blood group was the same. In those days, remember, we had no HLA matching, just went by blood groups. And so we decided to transplant Dorrit. We first of all went to see Dr. Sam Street, who was the chief medical officer. And he said, well, there was no law against transplantation. There's no law for it, so we could go ahead. He would give us all his blessing. And he would also come down and watch the operation. Well, he came down the afternoon in the theater, and with the assistance of all the heads of surgical firms at KPH, Henry Shaw, Mickey Roper, John McCarty, Ivor Campbell's anesthetist, Grandma Fraser, and myself, Ibel Ibo was a Nigerian resident in neurology, used to work with John McCarty. And he was the only one with a sense of history there, because with Dr. Sam Street watching, we did this operation, and afterwards Ibo went out and bought a six-pack of beers, says this is a historical occasion, we must drink to it. I never thought so at all. Now, we use for suturing the vessels 40 siliconized silk, which is really what you wouldn't think about these things, not at all. But that is silk that has been made smooth by an impregnation with silicone. And for immunosuppression, we used prednisone. This was a state-of-the-art immunosuppression. Prednisone, azathioprine, still use both of these, actinomycin C, and cobalt unit. We used cobalt 2,000 rads on days 2, 4, and 6 in an attempt to get the spotting cells from the immune system coming around to spot the foreign stuff that's in the body. The spotting cells would go back and report back and say, look, there's a foreign agent in the right groin of this patient, must attack it. Then the attacking cells would come in and reject it. So we used to irradiate with cobalt 2,200 rads on days 2, 4, and 6. Interestingly, I went to a transplant conference in London, 1995, and we were talking about various things we were doing for transplants. And a young Chinese surgeon, a brilliant chap, came up and said that they had a novel way of now treating transplants on the investigation. They were using the linear accelerator, which is modern day for cobalt, to irradiate the graft on days 2, 4, and 6 to catch cells coming. So I kept quiet afterwards when they spoke and said, you know, that is what we used to do way, way back in the 70s. He was amazed. He hadn't heard about this. Now, that patient died on the 30th day. She was putting out a lot of urine every day. She was okay from her renal failure, but she suddenly developed a hemorrhage in the groin and died. And reading up afterwards, it was one of the complications of siliconized silk, in that it creates a little vascular reaction and they can hemorrhage and bleed. In 1971, we transplanted Derek Wilson, age 13, Montwin Plummer, age 13, both the pediatric cases. And Derek Wilson died 18 years later. One night he developed a headache, wasn't feeling well, and went to a hospital. And a junior doctor examined him and said, oh, it must be your blood urease high. It must be renal failure. And he put him on dialysis that night. He died. He had a berry aneurysm, and with a heparin for dialysis, aneurysm popped, and that was that, really bled. Montwin Plummer is really our star patient. She was done late 1971, and I'll talk about her again later, but just to say that she's now a nursing sister, a nursing supervisor, as they call it, in Baltimore. Her daughter is a veterinary surgeon, and she is alive and well some 40 odd years later. She had another transplant done 4 years ago. The original transplant eventually failed, and she was done by the son of a Jamaican surgeon up in Baltimore, but she's alive and well. In 1972, we had a blessing. Dr. George Nicholson came to work with us as a nephrologist, and he was able to set the nephrological care of these patients straight. Up to that point, I was relying heavily on prednisone, which is an excellent drug for transplants. It stops rejection. But of course, if you give big doses of prednisone, you get other complications. I didn't care about other complications. I wanted the transplant to do well. So if they started to show any sign of rejection, I'd hit them with heavy doses of prednisone, which would keep them going from the transplant point of view. DW'd a patient a while ago, Mr. Williams. When he died, he had a vascular necrosis of his hip, and he had cataracts. That was all from the high dose of prednisone, which I'd be giving him. But he lasted for 18 years. The present time, the patients we do know are mainly due to diabetes. And live transplantation came into vogue for us in the 80s. It's a much easier operation, a better operation, a planned operation, because we can match the patients carefully, do all the workup, and do it as a set procedure. The cadaver transplants are usually done 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock. That's when all these kidneys come in and have to be transplanted. A kidney transplant is not put where the kidney comes from. The kidney lies up here. The transplant is put in the groin, much like a long hernia incision. I won't bore you with these. That's just the vein, transplanted artery, and the ureter. That should be in the past. That's a young surgeon after a transplant. That is Montewin, a plumber, after her transplant. And as I said before, she has done extremely well. This is a team, I think, taken in the 90s. You'd recognize people there, Dr. Hope Russell, Professor Barton, Dr. Donaldson, Mark Cadogan, Aiken. That was a team. That's just to show you that transplant is not a one-man procedure. It takes a team, a big team, to really make it work. And this was a team meeting before a live transplant, the day before. Transplant in the West Indies. Puerto Rico started transplanting in the 80s, and they now have a well-organized transplant program. Of course, Puerto Rico is really US of A, and they have all the facilities and all the immunosuppression and everything, so they transplant on a regular basis. They have a good renal program. Cuba transplanted to in the 70s. They are very advanced in transplantation. In fact, the major towns in Cuba all have a hospital devoted to renal failure. So in that hospital, only renal failure, they do hemodialysis, look after renal patients, and they have the transplants with the transplant teams. They do a great number of transplants and are very efficient and good. Barbados started in 1987, and they are much like us. They have had a lull in their transplant program. They recently sent a surgeon to Australia to train, and the surgeon has been back for about a year or two, and they are now in the process of organizing to get the transplant program restarted. Trinidad transplanted after Barbados, about 89-90, but they now have a very good transplant program. They, however, work with a team from England, and they transplant like once a month, once every 2 months. Team comes down from England, helps them with their transplants, and they did about 30, 40 last year. Not sure how many they have done this year. Now, Jamaica has a transplant program, still has a transplant program, even though it's been dormant, because of a number of factors. One, the cadaver program suffers because we need a transplant coordinator, which we'll talk about in a minute, to go out and find the cadaver that at least a patient who will become a cadaver with a head injury who is not going to live. Find the patient, organize a team, get everything set up, and usually that happens, as I said, early morning. So the person has got to be ready to really not sleep when they call him from the accident and emergency at 2:30, they have a head injury, was willing to go down and see this patient. The other thing that interferes with transplant in Jamaica is that our transplants used to come back to the nephrology clinic with the transplants failing. It's a live transplants. We'd wonder why. And then we would ask them and they would admit that they have mortgaged the house, the cows, the goats, everything. They have no more money to buy the immunosuppressives. Immunosuppressives costed up to last year $1,500 a month. So unless you can afford that money, transplantation without supplementation or help from the government is just not on. The future. Everywhere, every hospital must start back doing cadaver transplants. That's where I get kidneys from, because we have so many accident cases at KPH every week. We should be able to do at least 2 transplants a week easily at KPH. The amount of head injuries we have now, back in the 70s, we used to vet at least 1 patient, 1 cadaver donor every 2 weeks. As it would turn out, some of them weren't suitable, others you couldn't find next of kin, and some others had infections or other things that made them not good candidates. So we ended up doing a transplant every 6 months or transplant every 3 months, but we would transplant often. Now what we need now is to use all the cadaver donors that come in and do transplants. We need to do this, we need a dedicated transplant coordinator. This is somebody who's willing to get up and go down, vet patients, call the team, get everything organized so that we can transplant. There should be at least 2 transplant teams ready to go in every center, because if at any time you can get a cadaver donor, we must have a transplant team ready. So we must have 1 in each specialty. The recipient team, the donor team, the perfusion team, anesthetist, everybody should be ready. Therefore, to make this work, we'd need 2 transplant teams in each center. Sharing of kidneys. In Canada, where I worked, they used to share kidneys. We would go and take out both kidneys from the donor. That's a cadaver donor. And we would use the better kidney in our institution, and the one that didn't look so good, we'd send off to anywhere that had one that matched that kidney. In fact, what the practice in Canada was to allow the chief and his team to take out the kidney that's going to be used in their hospital. Then the residents would get a chance to take out the other kidney. So the hospital is getting the second kidney. They always got a kidney that was not as good as the first kidney. And add to that the fact that it had to be put in ice and had to travel by plane. They usually ended up with a kidney that was usually good, but it was never as good as the first kidney. Now, inter-island transplants, sharing of kidney inter-island is a no-no here. When you think of the milk run between Kingston and Trinidad, it takes about 8 hours stopping various islands to get there, and it runs once every evening, and a kidney can really be kept with slush and perfusion and ice for about 12 hours to be working. Keep it for 24 hours, yes, but that kidney must be properly checked before it's put in. So it would be dangerous, I feel, to be sending kidneys to other islands. Moreover, since we will have 3 transplant units here, where there's one in Cornell Regional, KPH, and I'm hopeful that they one at the university, so we can actually share inter-island kidneys. What we need to do is get a local HLA typing. HLA, human lymphocyte antigen, is a good way to match a kidney now. What we used to do in the old days is ABO compatibility, the blood groups. If it matched as a blood group, you'd use it, and most of them worked. In fact, with the modern immunosuppression, we can still use ABO compatibility, because if the blood group is matched with the immunosuppression we have now, it should work. But HLA typing makes it very easy to see if a kidney matches with the recipient, so that the chances of a rejection are greatly reduced. Subsidized immunosuppression, the cost of immunosuppression works against this. What we need is for the government to step in and subsidize immunosuppression, the cost of it, so that patients won't lose their kidneys because they have no money, having had a kidney transplanted. This is very important for live donor transplants, because you take out somebody's good kidney, put it in another person, and then they lose it because they can't afford immunosuppression. If it's a cadaver donor, the old time immunosuppression we had is a ephthalpine, prednisone. That's not expensive. Cyclosporine, we can use that. But when it comes onto the modern stuff that should be used in live donors to prevent rejection, that's a must. Xenotransplantation, something for the future. In fact, the future is now. It's being used where you take out kidneys from pigs and monkeys. They claim it's not just the matching, but they are closer to humans. And these kidneys can work. The longest a xenotransplant has lasted is about 2 weeks, but they figure with the new types of immunosuppression, they'll reach a stage where a xenotransplant will be able to last much longer. So in the future, you can go to a farm, look and choose a pig or a monkey and say, I like that one. Okay, and they can take out a kidney, put a new. One of the problems with this, and it's a minor problem, I suppose, is that chimerism tends to occur, where when you transplant a kidney, the transplant affects the behavior of the host. So you may have a chimpanzee kidney in, and you start to climb a tree, or you may go and play in mud or something. But immunocompatibility. Now that's a new aim of immunosuppression. Immunosuppression is to suppress the body from attacking non-self. Immunocompatibility is to mask, let the immune system not be, or to mask the graft so it appears normal to the immune system, so the immune system doesn't attack it. And there's a lot of effort being put into this part of immunosuppression. One of the answers to transplants is to have a mobile artificial kidney. This started off in 1966, long before most of you were born. And they were working on it then, and the promise then was that within a year or two, we'd have a mobile artificial kidney, one you wear under your shirt that's attached to your body, and you can walk around with it, dialyze slowly. The promise is still the same. It does not come to fruition. When you think that that is an artificial kidney, size of it, blood going into the patient, access sites. The blood goes through this and is purified, sent back to the patient. And we're trying to make that now into a little thing you can wear under your shirt. Of course, the problems are access, infection, and heparinization. These are really the bugbear problems with that. Stem cell kidneys are really in the future, where you can, when you go into renal failure, they'll take out some of your lymphatic tissue, get your stem cells, and they can grow your own kidney so that you won't have the problems of rejection. Grow an own kidney, put back in you, and you can live. These experiments on this are going on in dogs, and they have dogs now living for at least a month on stem cell kidneys, where they have cloned a kidney from your own tissue, on your own kidneys, to put back into you. Having said that, when things get tough and you have to retire, you have to find a living somehow. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prof, for taking us through the past, the present, and the future. We'd like to invite the second presenter, which is Dr. Maolynne Miller. She is a pediatrician and a pediatric nephrologist. She's been with us since 1984 in December after her training. Sick kids in Toronto, where she did her nephrology and pediatric training. And she's also the CEO, the founder, the head wash and buckle cook, as they call it in Jamaica, for Jamaica Kidney Kids Foundation, which has been very instrumental in helping a lot of children who have kidney failure. And as you know, these things can be very, very expensive. And Dr. Miller is gonna present on diabetes and the children. So help me to welcome her.
Good afternoon. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to speak, and let's hope you'll keep awake. So bearing in mind what that slide is saying, I'm hoping I won't just give you a mama talk, but something a little bit more stimulating. Now, childhood is a time where children should be carefree. It's a magical time where children are free to be happy, play, and have no concerns. They can use their imagination, and it should be the most wonderful time of their life. However, the circumstances in our country put a strain on the kids, and there are a lot of things that they have to cope with which they ought not to. Fortunately, diabetes is not one of these. So at this age, under age 12, it would be very, very exceedingly unusual to find a child with diabetes who has renal impairment from it. So in fact, under the age of 12, the diabetic kidney disease is not usually a problem. However, it rears its ugly head in late adolescence when the children are coping with puberty, acne, exams. They have concerns with their own body image and their sexuality. So this is when the problems are usually seen. A child with diabetes may have renal disease either from the diabetes itself, but a child who has renal disease may develop diabetes because of the treatment for the renal disease or because of the underlying problem which had led to the kidney problem in the first place. So the talk will deal with renal disease in the diabetic child, in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes, a little bit about the histology, the clinical features, screening for diabetic nephropathy and treatment. But we'll also say a word about diabetes in the child with renal disease as a primary event, renal disease in the obese child, and the child with diabetes and chronic kidney disease. Now a little bit about the epidemiology of diabetes. It's not uncommon. In a study from the US in 2009, it was estimated that over 190,000 children under the age of 20 did have diabetes. Raghu Bersingh and McGrawder, looking at the admissions to Bustamante Children's Hospital between 1985 and 1995, found that in children under the age of 13 years, type 1 diabetes constituted 1 in every 1,000 admissions, and the age at presentation, most kids were between the ages of 8 and 12. Typically, type 1 diabetes is a prototype in children, as was confirmed in the study by Tolerid et al. Between 1999 and 2004, in which type 1 diabetes was less than the type 2, and only 16% of children under the age of 18 with diabetes had type 2 diabetes. So even with the obesity epidemic in Jamaica, type 1 is still the most common type in the Jamaican young people population. However, over the last 20 years with the obesity epidemic, there has been a rise in the type 2 diabetes in children. In certain countries like Taiwan and Japan, type 2 diabetes is in fact more common than type 1. Type 2 diabetes is also more common in minorities. So in non-Hispanic whites, the prevalence is only 5.5%, but it goes up to 38% in African Americans, Hispanics, and Asian Pacific Islanders, and up to 80% in some American Indians, the Pima Indians, who seem to have a genetic predisposition to diabetes. So what is diabetic renal disease or diabetic nephropathy? It's defined as chronic renal disease associated with long-term diabetes. The earliest detectable manifestation is microalbuminuria. Overt advanced disease with renal failure is very rare in childhood and even in adolescence because the onset is usually 10 to 15 years after the diagnosis of diabetes has been made. However, histological changes of diabetic nephropathy are evident from 1.5 to 5 years after diabetes has started, even though there are no indicators clinically of its being present. So during this period of time before overt disease is present, there is a window of opportunity where reversal of the renal disease may be possible. The cumulative risk of diabetic nephropathy is 25 to 50% after you've had diabetes for 25 years in both type 1 and type 2. But in type 2 diabetes, there are so many other risk factors such as obesity and a high incidence of hypertension and hyperlipidemia, the incidence may actually be higher. The prevalence of microangiopathy, which is a disease process which gives rise both to the eye disease and the kidney disease in diabetes, is 4 to 20% in type 1 diabetes, but is rare before puberty. However, in children who have very poorly controlled diabetes, these changes may occur even before puberty, but this is unusual. So what do you see under this slide? So in the early stages, you may see just thickening of the glomerular and tubular basement membrane, the glomerulus being the filter for the kidney. 5 to 7 years after diabetes has started, the mesangium, which is a connecting tissue inside of the glomerulus, becomes in hypercellular and enlarged. And also this interstitial area of the kidney becomes enlarged as well. Now the rates at which this progression occurs will vary depending on the diabetes control. At the stage where you get renal impairment, you will have mesangial proliferation, basement membrane thickening, interstitial expansion, some scarring now, the fibrosis, tubular atrophy, and glomerulosclerosis, which is a hallmark of diabetic kidney disease. In type 2, the histology, which is how the kidney looks under the microscope, is variable. So if you have a GFR of greater than 60 mils per minute per 1.73 meters squared, which is just mildly reduced renal function, with micro or macroalbuminuria, 50% will have typical diabetes changes, but the majority are not going to have the typical diabetes changes. and the kidney may either look normal, or you may just see fibrosis in the interstitium or abnormal changes in the blood vessels. And sometimes you may see nothing at all. So if your kidney function is not too bad, even if you have micro or macroalbuminuria, you may not have typical diabetes changes in type 2. However, if your kidney function has started to decline and you have micro or macroalbuminuria, you are more likely going to have changes of true diabetic nephropathy. If your renal function is impaired and you have no protein in your urine, then you're usually going to see severe vascular disease in the kidney and interstitial changes, and less than 40% of those may have typical diabetic lesions. So what causes this? What causes the sclerosis in the glomerulus? The blood vessels become narrowed because of the line, the walls around it become thicker, and the blood vessel supply to the kidney reduces, and you get ischemic injury. Hyperglycemia, which is high blood sugar, triggers certain metabolic changes, and you get protein glycation, increased orbital production, transmination growth factor beta, and other mediators, which increase basement membrane synthesis and mesangial matrix production, and increase capillary permeability. There's also increased angiotensinogen production, and this puts you at greater risk for hypertension. So what are the indicators of renal disease? The kidney may just be large, and this may be seen even in children who have not yet demonstrated microalbuminuria. Then the next step is microalbuminuria, then later macroalbuminuria, which is heavier proteinuria. Then the other step is renal impairment, along with hypertension and heavier protein. So what is micro and what is macroalbuminuria? Macroalbuminuria is albuminuria that is detectable on the dipstick, or 300 milligrams per deciliter. But remember, not all the protein in your urine is albumin, and children who have type 2 diabetes sometimes produce more of a tubular protein than albumin. So even in the face of what looks like glomerular disease, they may show no microalbuminuria. Microalbuminuria is the earliest sign of diabetic kidney disease, and the definition varies. So 15 to 200, 20 to 200 micrograms per minute on a timed urine, or a spot urine sample of albumin to creatinine of 30 to 300 milligrams per gram of creatinine. Now, the sample has to be collected properly. You can't just get ideally, you shouldn't just get a person checking the protein to creatinine in the urine just after walking around. Children are very frequently have orthostatic proteinuria, which is protein in the urine on walking around, but not when you're supine. So the urine should be collected first thing in the morning before they've had a chance to walk around. And one needs to make sure there's no vulvovaginitis, there's no urinary tract infection, the child doesn't have a fever, because these are all non-renal events that may cause protein in the urine transiently. And albumin should be present in at least two of three of the samples. Microalbuminuria will be present in 26% of children who have had diabetes for 10 years or more, and 51% after 19 years. However, there are other pitfalls with the measurement of microalbumin in children. Children are not as big as adults. Creatinine excretion is higher in boys. Girls have smaller size. So normal values may overestimate the albumin excretion in the normal values that are set for adults across the board, may overestimate the albumin excretion in younger girls, whose urinary albumin is usually small, but their creatinine and body mass is small as well. So the albumin, the ratio may be an overestimate. Macroalbuminuria is a urinary albumin excretion of over 300 milligrams per day, or more than 300 milligrams per gram of creatinine. What's the natural history here? So the microalbuminuria will progress to macroalbuminuria and then overt diabetic nephropathy, renal impairment, and end-stage renal disease. This is really quite depressing. Type 1 diabetes, after the onset of microalbuminuria, the risk of progression to renal impairment increases 50 times. So the hope that is that you should try and prevent microalbuminuria in the first place. GFR reduction or glomerular filtration rate reduction will occur in 16% once microalbuminuria has started, but even in 24% who do not have microalbuminuria. Because as we mentioned before, with kidney damage, especially in the children with type 2 diabetes, the protein is tubular and will not be picked up by microalbumin measurements. However, the story is not all that. It could be worse, because although some people who have a macroalbuminuria are still able to maintain a reasonable GFR for a period of time. So with all that negativity, the good news is that microalbuminuria, which reflects just endothelial injury, which is injury to the lining of the blood vessel, is potentially reversible. And regression of this is very much more likely once there is good blood pressure and blood sugar control. In children aged 13 to 17, aggressive diabetic control reduced microalbuminuria by 54%. The bad news is that if you're using urinary albumins to guide you as to when the problem is occurring, you may miss some in whom the proteinuria is tubular and not albumin. What are some of the risk factors for developing diabetic nephropathy? The largest one is hyperglycemia. However, it seems propensity for developing diabetic nephropathy seems to be more likely if you are female, you've had diabetes for a longer time, you have uncontrolled hypertension, you have microalbuminuria. It seems to be more likely to occur when there's puberty, and it's worsened if you have hyperlipidemia and smoke. There are children who smoke, teenagers smoke. There also is a genetic predisposition. If you have a sibling or a parent who has diabetes, or a family history of hypertension, or a particular genotype, you are then at greater risk for developing diabetic nephropathy. There's a greater prevalence of type 2 diabetes in youth, as they have the diabetic nephropathy progresses faster with these children than those who have type 1. And this is because they're often hypertensive and don't know it, they're hyperlipidemic and don't know it, and it's harder to modify their risk factors. There's a trial that looked at diabetics who are well controlled, and despite good control in all the areas, they had more problems with the blood sugar control. So they were on various insulin or metformin regimes, and the single predictive factor of progression of nephropathy was in fact the diabetic glucose control. And males who are hypertensive were also at greater risk. Prevention. We should try to keep the blood sugar at a normal level, controlling blood pressure, hyperlipidemia, using ACE inhibitors, stop smoking, educate, diet, and exercise. Prevention is variably effective. ACE inhibitors are the best, but there are other agents, calcium channel blockers, alpha receptors, thiazides, lipid restriction. You need to control the blood pressure. In children, there is no set value for a hypertensive blood pressure. It depends on their age, height, and sex, and you therefore need to have in your office a growth chart and blood pressure tables. You try to keep the blood pressure at the 50th percentile or less, or for adolescents, you shouldn't have blood pressures as high as 120/80. We mentioned that before. So your indications for ACE inhibitors would be hypertension, diabetes, and microalbuminuria, or macroalbuminuria, but not just for diabetes alone if none of those factors are present. You would start screening these children between 11 and 12, And if they went into puberty earlier, you would start treating earlier. And you'll also start screening once the diabetes has been present for 4 to 5 years at least. As we mentioned, you should make sure your sample is properly collected. Annual evaluation should be done and repeats if the numbers are elevated. Good and tight diabetic control is needed. Calculation of GFR in children is not, we don't usually use 24-hour urines, and we use a formula called the Schwartz formula. But as a general rule of thumb, the normal creatinine in a child is age times 10 minus 10. Once they are under the age of 5, it's less than 40. So the normal values that are ticked off on your general lab forms will not apply to children. So if you're not aware of this, you will miss renal impairment. If a child with diabetes develops renal impairment, one should also look for other causes and not just attribute it to the diabetes, and a renal biopsy may be necessary. Once a child has gone into renal failure, then the usual modes of therapy for renal failure will trip in: fluids, dietary protein restriction, phosphate restriction, sodium and potassium restriction, adding bicarbonate, phosphate binders, vitamin D, potassium binders, as well as vitamins, and erythropoietin injections to raise the hemoglobin. It's very, very important to remember that once you have renal impairment, drug excretion is going to be affected. So if your diabetic patient now develops renal impairment, you need to go and check tables for every single drug that patient is on. Because even the number of the oral blood sugar lowering agents are renally excreted and will cause hypoglycemia in the doses that you've been accustomed to using. So you need to Google and check what dose, which if your drug you're using is, in fact, does have to be reduced. So end-stage renal disease will require dialysis and transplantation. Obviously, this will be more challenging than in a child who does not have diabetes. So diabetes in the child with renal disease is a complication of the disease or the treatment. Now, these kids are already taking about 10 or 20 medications for their renal failure. I think it's just a very cruel thing for them to develop diabetes, because now they're faced with insulin injection on top of the erythropoietin injections. If they weren't visiting the hospital enough for their renal failure, now they have to go to endocrine clinic as well. And they have further dietary restrictions, which they had difficulty complying with just for the renal failure. And of course, to the parent, the cost increases. And this is adolescence, when they're normally rebellious, even if they don't have anything to be rebellious about. So, you know, it's even worse now when they have a disease or two diseases that set them apart from other children. There is always going to be a problem with compliance, with diet, medication, fluids. Parents now say, you're grown up, now you can look after yourself, but actually they're not taking the medication. And at this stage, deterioration in renal function is possible. They start to become depressed, and when they become depressed, they become even more non-compliant. We do have an adolescent clinic at the hospital where children who have difficulty coping with all these multiple demands on them can get counseling and meet children who have similar problems. There is also support groups that can, and counseling with psychologists that help them through this difficult period. Now, with a younger child with diabetes and with renal failure and diabetes, the problem is with the parent who, there's parental burnout, and the children run and cheat when they know that they're not being watched. They don't like the needles, and the needles are painful. So a lot of support, emotional support, has to be given to these families. And understanding, if there's non-compliance, instead of being angry with them, find out why and see how you can help. And just a quick note on obesity-related renal injury. In children, overweight is diagnosed as a BMI greater than 25 kilograms per meter squared, and obesity is greater than 30 kilograms per meter squared for population-specific standards. Obesity increases the risk of renal injury, even in the absence of diabetes. Microalbuminuria may be seen in obese children and is an early predictor of chronic kidney disease in them. it is not uncommon to find this in obese children and adolescents. And the early markers are albuminuria, microalbuminuria, beta 2 microglobulinemia, and there are some other markers in the urine which are expensive and would have to be sent abroad, but the NGAL and KIM molecule, if present, suggests that chronic kidney disease is happening. In these children, the histology will show focal segmental sclerosis. The proteinuria may actually be absent, and nephrotic syndrome is less likely. In the extremely obese kids with normal renal function, you find enlarged glomeruli, podocyte hypertrophy, increased mesangial matrix, mesangial cell proliferation, and you get the albuminuria and thickening of the basement membrane, which kind of looks just like what we just described with the diabetic nephropathy. Obesity induces hyperinsulinemia, and then the hyperglycemia, and you can get type 2 diabetes as well. And the glomerular basement membrane thickening correlates with the cholesterol and triglyceride levels as well as the blood sugar levels. So in obesity, you have increased glomerular filtration rate, increased renal plasma flow, and the lipids tend to induce proteinuria and the glomerular increase in size. Fat cells generate angiotensin, which can cause hypertension, quite apart from the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. And the fat cells also induce inflammatory mediators, which contribute to the glomerulosclerosis. So there is a thought that people who get renal disease from obesity are susceptible individuals, because not every fat person is going to get glomerular disease. And there's a theory called the second hit theory, that patients who were born with reduced nephron mass, either because they were premature or they had congenital renal disease with fewer numbers of glomeruli in there, or they had a genetic disorder which caused fewer number of functioning units in the kidney. So those kids become obese, and the obesity then acts on those children with the reduced nephron number to cause those smaller nephrons to now increase in size, and as they reach their capacity, eventually you get hyperfiltration, and they end up with the glomerular disease. So risk factors for these kids would be premature, small for gestational age, rapid catch-up growth, although people are happy to see that the little preemie who was really whingy in the nursery is now getting real fat. It's not necessarily a good thing. And early obesity and insulin resistance may develop. So it is recommended that, which we have not been doing, that these tiny prem infants, when they go out into the world, they should have blood pressure checks, and you should from time to time maybe check their urine for protein, and if there was any suspicion of renal injury in the newborn period, that their kidney ultrasounds be monitored at the time, and then maybe a year later to see that renal growth is normal. Now, how do you treat it? You need to treat hypertension, you need to treat the obesity, weight loss, diet, and exercise. You know that this weight loss, diet, and exercise is, you know, easier said than done. And in children who are morbidly obese, bariatric surgery may be recommended. Hyperlipidemia should be treated as well, since we know that that can contribute to their renal disease. So it is important to recognize the children who are at risk for getting the obesity-related nephropathy, and at least with their medical checkups, that blood pressures should be done and urinalysis done when you are seeing them, or at least twice a year. The high-risk ones in whom you are really suspicious, we said ultrasounds will help, check their UNEs, but remember age times 10 minus 10 as the normal. In summary, diabetic renal disease does not present in children under age 12, except in exceptional cases. It doesn't occur until diabetes has been there for more than 5 years. Obesity increases the risk of renal disease, both by obesity-related renal injury, as well as the fact that it makes you more likely to get type 2 diabetes and the diabetic disease, renal disease. Kidney disease in type 2 diabetes progresses more rapidly than in type 1, but early in the whole course of events, diabetic renal disease is potentially reversible. Diabetes control is the most, glucose control is the most important factor in reducing the risk of diabetic renal disease. It is important to monitor the risk factor patients for risk factors and try and control them as much as possible. As if you have the patient is just at the stage of microalbuminuria, this is reversible. All drugs given to patients with diabetes and CKD should be checked to ensure that the appropriate dose adjustments have been made. Childhood obesity needs to be treated as a public health emergency. But are we fighting a losing battle? These are the children. Education is important for the family and child, but the family parents are eating as well. Adults should set the example. They should do physical exercise, and there should be better food choices in the places that children frequent, like school. I'm wondering, diet and exercise is fine. We say it every conference, but how many people are actually successful with diet and exercise? I'm truly believing that instead of dealing with diabetic nephropathy and obesity-related injury, that maybe we should find some suppressant for the overweight kids. And I know this is not really appropriate, but I have not found any of my children get better with exercise and weight loss with exercise. And now exercise in the old day meant actually going outside. Exercise in the 21st century is this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Miller, for that insightful presentation. Our next presenter, Dr. Coretta Brown-Johnson. So she is a clinical behavior specialist and a clinical psychologist, and she has a specialist in crisis management. So which means if you have a hostage situation, you know, you can have somebody you can call on. Cognitive behavior specialist, so maybe Dr. Miller, we can link up with her to have some behavioral therapy for these children. And more importantly, she's a founder and executive director of 3PM International Foundation, which is a foundation that is really geared with specializes in youth services, assessment and behavioral modification, intervention, treatment, as well as other services. And she's worked with the previous prime ministers in, you know, developing things for the educational program in Jamaica. She's not new to the Diabetes Association of Jamaica. And right now she's gonna be presenting on the psychosocial management of patients with end-stage renal disease. And at this time I'd like to welcome Dr. Brown to the podium.
Thank you so much, Dr. Soyibo. Good afternoon, everyone. In listening to all the information being shared and trying to take it all in, digesting it page by page, moment by moment, syllable by syllable, the question comes to me, how does the patient feel? In going through the process, in going through the tests, in addressing whatever is happening in terms of the disease, whether it's end stage or dealing with the diabetic condition, are we really trying to make sure that at least the patient is psychologically, behaviorally, and emotionally as balanced as possible going through this process, which is already a stressful one based on its description and understanding. I tend to get involved a lot in the preventative side because I find we should be thinking future. And I heard one of our presenters earlier say the future is now. And I also tend to focus a lot on children in terms of how to best even try to distract them from the process that they're going through when they have to go through dealing with the elements of the diabetic condition, applying, taking insulin, whatever it is, dealing with their peers, their family, the visits, dialysis, I try to create an environment in whatever way to help them cope in a healthy way with that. So just to define end-stage renal disease, a debilitating chronic condition whereby the kidney failure requires artificial means of excretion for survival. Now I invite you to think about this and take a breath, because this is also sometimes a transition to death. I share with you case one. Diagnosed young adult, lived with diabetes for over 10 years, developed renal failure, died at 50 years old. Case two, 25 years old, just died yesterday, a friend of a friend. All they knew is that she was sick often, missed work sometimes, passed away yesterday. Case three, a child yet still developing, living with diabetes, developed renal failure and is now coping with the treatment of having been diagnosed with ESRD. I'm going to skip ahead because a lot has been shared in terms of the technicalities of the disease, the challenges, what happens internally from a medical perspective. But we also want to think about, as this person is going through the process, what's happening. Family support system and counseling or information sessions are critical before, during, and after. Now I pause here because when you think about where we are in understanding psychology, in understanding behavior modification locally, we are currently in transition, and that's a reality. Psychological services currently would fall under the mental health, the Ministry of Health, under their mental health services. And right now what that looks like, it's primarily headed by a psychiatrist. It tends to deal with issues in terms of behavior, in terms of ADHD, ADD, if somebody's schizophrenic, or they have other issues that leads to mental illness, that's what we tend to focus on. So we have not yet started to touch the tip of the iceberg as it relates to how do we really care for a patient that is going through this process, not to mention our young people. So we need a resultant support system wherever possible. Right now we have the child guidance units which are at the Bustamante Children's Hospital and at different hospitals and clinics across the country. How can we expand that to include psychological treatment services for our children and also maybe have a unit that addresses the transitional counseling that is required before, during, and after, because there are different levels that's required to deal with a patient transitioning through that process. Effective case management comes to mind. So if you think about the numbers currently in terms of all the people you may know, all the people or medical professionals are treating now, it goes into the thousands. How are we managing these cases? A team approach, I propose, is always best. Clinical counseling, pre and post diagnosis, especially if patients already are diabetic, to include full and clear explanation of the medical condition. A needs assessment can also be done. What is required for this patient as they will go through? What is required medically? What is required emotionally, what is required behaviorally. And behaviorally would mean, for example, how many times per day they have to ingest medicine, how many times they have to do dialysis. This has to be managed as well, effectively. and explained to the patient clearly. Full and clear explanations of the step-by-step requirements and demands of care. Now, this is a process which really takes a team approach in mind. I know some of it is being practiced, but as it relates to psychological services, again, we are in transition. So number one, defining the process. A medical specialist, who is your medical doctor, who is probably your nephrologist, who is going to define for you what's happening on a physical level and treat biochemically or with transplant or whatever is required for you to move through managing this challenge. At that time, then you'll have a diagnosis happening. Here I'm proposing again that we have a team that is explaining clearly to the patient that is what is happening, counseling with planning. How are you going to manage this? There are economic factors. Do you have support? That's a critical question because some people go through this process and they're alone. They do not have anybody to support them, to talk to understand what's happening. Psychological support, end phase transition. The discharge process also requires management. And post-consultant follow-up. We tend to drop the patient off when we're done. Here, take your medication, go home, figure it out. Do we call them to see how they're doing? Do we know if they're taking the medication? Do we have somebody following that up? That's also where we have relapses happening. That's also where, because a patient may not necessarily understand why they need to do this, there are lapses because they go, try, I can't bother stop what I'm doing during the day to go and inject myself or to go and do that dialysis, so you find that care is impacted there as well. Now, looking at the potential stressors, we have culture, personality. The patient is here. So you have culture, personality, psychological functioning. Now, one of the things that came to me while listening as well is if we've possibly ever had cases where a patient develops or shows signs of other types of mental illnesses while having to deal with being diagnosed with end-stage renal disease. Sorry. So we have culture impacting how they do what they do, and within culture you have subcultures happening as well. Personality, who they are, how they deal with challenges, how they deal with stressors, life changes. Psychological functioning, is it well balanced? Is it able to take this information in and really apply it in a way that's effective? Support, we alluded to that earlier. And then, as a result of those potential stressors, you have other sub-stressors, which are the effects of the illness, the family dynamics, mommy not talking to daddy, cousin not talking to auntie, who can help me? Maybe you live with somebody and you don't have a good relationship with them, but now you are in a vulnerable state and need support, and that becomes another issue to manage. Dietary constraints, time restrictions, especially if you are a productive member of society, you will have to think about getting to work on time, or taking time off from work to manage a disease. Functional limitations. Sometimes patients have to have a limb amputated. That's also requiring transitional care as well, because they now have to move from being fully able-bodied to be functioning with possibly one leg. Changes in employment, relationships with staff, role change, change in sexual function. These are areas we don't tend to talk about. When we think about a patient being a whole being, these are aspects and realities of their daily lives. Medication effects, awareness of impending death. So as you think about the patient going through this process, having to deal with all of these stressors, impacting upon them as they move through the management of the disease, it becomes critical then that we handle with care, as much care as we possibly can. Now also, this is an expounded version of where we were before. So here you have the patient in the center. partner, spouse, family, close friends, hopefully systems of support in place to provide and help with the transitional process of sometimes even accepting that there is going to be a change in how my life flows. Employer, the physician, the dialysis staff, friends, the outer circle, social status, religion, what do I believe, components of faith, dialysis provider, all of these things are spheres of influence which impacts upon that patient. Looking at new development. Now, having been involved primarily with children who have had to cope with the effects of diabetes as a medical challenge over the past few years in partnership with the Diabetic Association, I do a yearly camp which includes children who have been diagnosed with diabetes. And what has happened is that the first year they came, looking at how they maneuvered themselves during the day, I had to negotiate to say, no, look, the people on staff, the volunteers, need the information to be able to assist the students that come. So we have to be trained in how to manage and care for these students while they're with us. And as a result of that, we actually have a team. We have the team that comes in from the Diabetic Association, and they're actually there every day now. The camp runs for 2 weeks, and they come every day. They test the insulin levels. They actually order the lunch. They make sure that the children are eating properly, that type of thing. They're eating on time, because sometimes they're doing activities. They get lethargic, blood sugar goes down. That might happen, and we don't even know how to approach dealing with that, because you might just look at the child and say, oh, you just look a little tired. But when you understand what's happening, the approach is quite different. So now I'm looking at showing some data here. And this candidate, just a sample, with a diabetic medical challenge, she's 15 years old, and this is over a period of 3 years. The camp runs for 2 to 4 weeks. So when you look at this chart, you see here in year one, which is the green, the behavioral challenges are almost at 100%. Then the social challenges, which are the blue, you see where that is in year one. As we go forward to year three, year two would have been the best year, but year three created that dynamic because we also had changes in terms of interaction, who showed up so and interacted with this child. So therefore, the behavior spiked a little bit in year three. But the goal here is to really show that with a process of intervention in mind, you can actually see results. And this happens once per year. So imagine if we actually implement a process consistently as we manage people who are having these medical challenges. As I stated before, I tend to get involved into the preventative side of things, and I also try to create solutions that assist in helping the client, the patient, to really not focus too much on the disease, because that in itself is being managed medically. So we try to make sure, especially the children, from the standpoint of making sure they're balanced psychologically, emotionally, and behaviorally in coping and dealing with the disease. Now here, we also partner with the SDC, just showing that we can have partnerships in managing this process. Just a sample of what happens. They do computing. We have different volunteers coming from the SDC. They're all certified at the end of the camp. Last year, we had Miss Angie Middlehurst. I know those who are affiliated with the Diabetic Association would know Mrs. Middlehurst, who came in as an international guest for the camp last year. And you see Ade Soyibo and Charlene, who are staff at the Diabetic Association. So you see the setup. They're actually there every day providing care and support for the children who have this challenge. But just a synopsis here to show what's possible in terms of future management from a psychological perspective of patients, clients who have the challenge of the diabetic condition and also dealing with end stage renal disease.
My name is Carol Duque and I'm currently enrolled in the MFT program at Walden University. Since being at Walden, I've learned the importance of impacting social change on one's community. I have currently joined a foundation called 3PM International Foundation in Jamaica, which focuses on children and their families and providing support by either having counseling sessions, doing assessments, even providing interventions for communities. Each summer, the foundation puts on a camp for children called Children's World Camp, where we offer a plethora of activities to these children, and within those activities, there is always a lesson to be learned about conflict resolution, teamwork, respect, love, honor, those things that would get us through life and those things that will impact change within our community. We believe that children are our future, and that in working with children, we will impact change. During the camp, we use what is called the circle philosophy. On a circle, everyone can see each other, which allows for open and honest communication. No one is more important than the other. Power is balanced. Communication is shared. All comes to one mind and heart. All perspectives, however different, are respected. This is done at least 4 times throughout the day, which even allows for consistency while working with children. The best way to impact change in our communities is to impact the children, as they are our future.
Oh, I'm going to miss hearing that from all of you. Just walking around, I've heard the cheer, and I tell you, it did put a smile on my face to hear how lively y'all sound, how energetic y'all sound, and how excited y'all sound. So I'm really proud of you, and I think y'all deserve a round of applause for completing the entire 2 weeks and 3 days. I'm really proud of all of you. And I've seen growth, I've seen changes, and I hope that you take whatever you've learned from this experience, you take it and put it forward. Okay, guys? So I expect that from all of you. Just the way you have expectations of us all here, Uncle Joel, Uncle Shaquille, Auntie Talicia when she goes back, we all have expectations. So guys, I wish you all the best. I love all of you, and thank you for coming out and sharing this experience with us. Okay?
Teamwork makes a dream work. So let's lend a helping hand.
Now, when you look at that, you cannot tell who were the diabetic children. They were included, they are included in a way that they do not have to feel as if they're separate and apart from everybody else. Though we do understand that they're having to cope and deal with challenges, medical challenges that are serious. So what we do is we train the volunteers, and we actually have repeat students that come back, and actually one of our main volunteers now is diabetic, and he has become a camp coordinator. And what happens is that he assists us all in making sure that we can pinpoint whatever challenges come up during the day. So he roams, and he will say, okay, this person is having low blood sugar, so we have to separate them from the activity. We give them whatever they need, something to drink, some rest, give them time, and then they are reintegrated. So if you look at the model, the idea here is to understand that they are people too. They have lives too. And this challenge having to be managed, all we have to do is think about how is the patient feeling? Emotionally, psychologically and behaviorally, and that should drive our commitment to try and make sure that at least as we are treating medically and biochemically, that we are also taking care of them holistically. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Well, I do have, yes, sir. There are actually two questions out there.
All right. This question is really for Dr. Miller. I just wondered whether UTI, urinary tract infections, are a problem in the children that you see, especially the older ones. And if so, do you check for it in interpreting the microalbuminuria that that you will have before you?
Okay. I'm going to answer this on a theoretical basis because I don't look after diabetic children. I see children with renal disease, and none of the children in the age group that I look after, under 18, well actually under 16 at the hospital, has developed renal disease. But in checking for microalbuminuria, one should make sure that the child does not have a UTI first, at least even by the dipstick, so that if the sample has blood and protein and bacteria on the dipstick, don't send it for microalbumin, right? And they do tend to have urinary tract infections, and that certainly that is one element that should be checked before you spend time on an expensive test that may be invalid.
Second person.
Good afternoon, this is for Dr. Brown-Johnson. I was just wondering if there's any intervention given to parents or caregivers of the children with diabetes?
Yes, there's actually a support system in place for the parents because we actually follow up with them afterwards. There's an aspect too where I get involved in trying to have the Diabetic Association come into schools or go into schools to do screening so that they can find hypo and hyperglycemic children or children that are struggling with obesity as well, and also support the parents in trying to cope with the transition of dealing with that.
Just
so, yes, sorry, I was trying to find where you were. Yes.
Thanks. Just a follow-up question. Are they receptive to the offer of help from you?
Usually, I really do not get much resistance. The challenges come in where you have to find the resources.
Okay.
Because they have other life stressors going on as well. So it's trying to find the resources to support holistically as much as you're able. Also, some parents have challenges with coping and managing their own child, dealing with the disease, especially when they're going through the teenage stage and they want to do their own thing. They tend to call to talk that through. And sometimes the children that are at the camp, we have to talk them through that as well, show them the value. That type of thing.
Okay, just one last question. We have to, sure, go ahead.
Yes, I have a question for Professor Douglas. I'm just curious, do we have a formal organ donor system in Jamaica? And the second part of the question, how do you communicate to relatives who have just had member of their family had head injury that you need to take their organ, their kidney?
Well, first of all, as far as the donor system is concerned, we once had a system like what they have in America, where you put in your driver's license that you're willing to give your kidney if you're in an accident. Let it be known that that really is not on at all, because once you're dead, you no longer belong to you, you belong to your next of kin. So that on your license, just to inform your next of kin that you'd be willing. So if they agree, they still have to agree. And that's the only system that, well, that's the only way that that works. And the second question was?
You mentioned that the candidates are usually persons who have had a head injury. So I'm thinking an accident or so on. In that very important hour or 2 hours, how do you ask for a kidney when you're also communicating that the person will be demised?
Well, the head of the team usually takes that responsibility. And what you explain to the patient's relatives very carefully, patient has had an accident, they are not doing well. In fact, they are brain dead. Now they will sort of question that. In the past, long time ago when we first started, there's no such thing as brain death. We'd have to wait until the patient's heart stopped before we could take out the kidneys. But these days, since about 1980 odd, we have the concept that a neurologist comes in, two separate neurologists, examine the patient and says that they're dead, the brain is dead. We keep them alive by, is breathing with a ventilator, and we give them lots of fluids, and we explain to the relatives that this patient really is dead, we're just keeping them alive, and instead of their kidneys being wasted, at least a part of them will remain alive if we use the kidneys. There are other people who need the kidneys. A lot of them will say no. Actually, if a patient is an accident patient, the body belongs to the hospital. There are coroner's case, in which case we really want to play hardball. We can say, well, it doesn't matter. They have to have a postmortem. And the harvesting of the kidneys is the first part of the postmortem. We never do that anyway. If the relatives say no, if the relative says no, we leave it alone. The relative usually has got to agree. But if you can't find a relative, then we go ahead and take the kidneys, because the patient belongs to the hospital, been a coroner's case, and they must have a postmortem. And the first part of the postmortem is harvesting the kidneys. I don't think you realize it, but when you have a postmortem and you get back a body to be buried, you know, what's inside the body is just straw. You know that. It was just a shell you get back. All the organs are taken out and examined separately. So that in taking out the kidneys at first, it's just the start of the postmortem.
Okay, thank you very much. We have to close, but just to add, the team that does the interview is separate from the managing team. So the managing team will inform the transplant, the procurement team, that there's a patient potential, and they will approach the relative. So it wouldn't be the managing team that is going to approach them. So as to reduce conflict. Okay, thank you very much. That's been a wonderful session.